we want to find the domain of the composite functions f of g of x and g of f of x from the graph of f of x and the graph of g of x. So because we're not given the equations for f of x and g of x, determining the domain of our two composite functions can be more challenging. Let's start by determining the domain and range of f of x and g of x. Notice that we have a vertical asymptote here at x equals 0, which means the domain will not include 0 for f of x. So we'll have the open interval from negative infinity to 0, and the open interval from 0 to infinity. And then for the range, notice how it will not include the y value of negative 1. So we'll have the open interval from negative infinity to negative 1, and the open interval from negative 1 to infinity. And then for function g of x, notice how the domain will always be when x is greater than 0. So we'll have the open interval from 0 to infinity. And then for the range, notice how the graph goes up and down forever with no breaks. Therefore, the range is all real numbers, or from negative infinity to positive infinity. Now let's consider the domain of our composite functions. The domain of f of g of x must contain the restrictions of the domain of the inner function g of x and the restrictions of the domain of g of x such that the range of g of x is in the domain of the outer function f of x. So what this is really telling us is we start with the domain of the inner function, and then because the output of the inner function becomes the input into the outer function, we may have more restrictions on the domain of our composite function if the outputs of g, the inner function, are not possible inputs into f, or the outer function. So for the domain of f of g of x, we'll start with the restrictions for the domain of g of x, which is this interval here. But now we also have to compare the outputs of g to the possible inputs into f, the outer function. And we do have a slight problem because notice how 0 is not a possible input into function f, but 0 is an output from the inner function g. So we have to exclude the x value of g that would produce an output of 0 for function g. And if we consider this point here, where the x coordinate is 1 and the y coordinate is 0, this is telling us that when g has an input of 1, the output is 0. But since 0 cannot be an input into the outer function f, we must also exclude 1 from the domain of our composite function. So the domain of f of g of x will be this interval here from 0 to infinity, but we also have to exclude x equals 1, which means the domain of our composite function will be the open interval from 0 to 1 and the open interval from 1 to infinity. Now let's consider the domain of g of f of x. Again, we'll start with the restrictions of the domain of f, which is given by this interval here. But now we have to compare the outputs of f to the inputs of g. And notice how we have another issue because notice how all the outputs of f are not possible inputs into the outer function g. So we need to make more restrictions on this yellow interval here so that the outputs will only be from 0 to infinity. So let's take a look at the graph of f. We want to determine the interval for which the outputs of f are from 0 to infinity, which would be this piece of the graph here. So we have to exclude the values when x is greater than or equal to 1 and when x is less than 0, because these x values produce outputs of f that are not in the domain of the outer function g, which means the domain of our composite function g of f of x is going to be the open interval from 0 to 1. These are the only inputs for the inner function that produce outputs that are possible inputs into function g. So as you can see, determining the domain of composite functions graphically can sometimes be quite challenging, but I hope you found these two examples helpful.